representing the Digital Research and Publications Group today. Part of our job is to work with editor Diane Davis to publish Currents in Electronic Literacy, which began in 1999 and features work from both graduate students and faculty members. In our forthcoming 2012 issue of Currents, we've taken up the themes of memories, technologies, and rhetorics. The interviews and articles in this forthcoming issue ask questions about the effects of technology on thought processes, archival practices, transmission of embodied knowledge, and public remembrance. Dramatic pause. This year, we also worked with editor Justin Hodgson to publish The Jump, or the Journal for Undergraduate Multimedia Projects, which is in its third year. The most recent issue of The Jump is titled Poems and Monuments, and it features student projects from 5 students from across the country. In honor of the focus on memory in both publications this year, we'd like to ground our presentation today in the Ars Memorativa, or the long and varied tradition of visualization that foregrounds associative logics and ties ideas to places. Following this approach, we'll move together through the works of many of our published authors from the past year, and we'll begin with a focus on the theme of memory, move through technology, and end finally with rhetoric. In her interview with Currents, Barbara Biesecker, it'll go, discusses the role of memorials, monuments, and eventual rhetoric in the shaping of publics of citizens. And she grounds this discussion in the events of 9/11, the Holocaust, and World War II. Trevor Hoig also addresses physical structures in rhetorical theory in his article for Currents, A Building That Recalls. Hoig argues that housing helps us to navigate the tensions between memory and forgetting, and that housing is an important site of resistance, wounding, and healing. Rather than considering external sites of memory like housing and memorials, Shrilina Ghosh helps us to focus on embodied memory. She outlines an emergent controversy among practitioners of a traditional Indian dance and asks what is lost and gained when cultural memory is disembodied and disseminated through technology. Our undergraduate students in The Jump, students like Cecilia Jones, are also using digital technology to forge intimate reader relationships through memory. Jones's My Story uses the Wix platform to invite readers into her deeply personal triumphs and tragedies that are rooted on her family's horse farm in North Carolina. Jones's story also exemplifies the success of our ongoing effort with The Jump to improve accessibility. I'll share a bit about our experience with accessibility now, but we really encourage you to come over during the breakout sessions and play with the accessibility features yourself if that's something that interests you. In an effort to foster a more collaborative process of developing these accessibility materials, the group has worked this year to develop a set of documents that outlines the processes for creating these materials so that undergraduates can do it themselves and do it with our help. That includes things like captioning videos, creating transcripts for audio and video content, and learning to make audio and textual descriptions for highly visual projects. We feel that having students involved in this, doing the accessibility work, helps them understand the importance of accessibility and also helps them maintain control over their projects when it comes to making decisions that are interpretive, like how to describe an image, for instance. For example, Tanya Patel recorded an audio description for her highly visual project 10 and 2 RU, which also uses the Wix platform. Patel's piece is a digital monument that uses an interactive iPhone interface to help viewers navigate through her research on the dangers of texting and talking while driving. Undergraduate multimedia composition is one of the many issues that Alex Reed discusses in his interview with Scott Nelson that will publish in Currents this year. Specifically, Reed is arguing about how copyright practices restrict access to materials that students might use in multimedia composition, specifically remixes. Student writing was also the focus of our recent workshop in the DWRL, where we were trying to familiarize our fellow instructors with the processes and venues in which their undergraduate students might publish, and help to walk them through some ways they might design courses and assignments to that end. In an effort to improve our own undergraduate journal, Mike Widener has designed a new interface for The Jump that will help streamline our editorial processes better feature student work and increase our accessibility. And we'll debut this new look in the new issue. Enabling and highlighting collaboration is an important mission of the Jump, which is why we publish alongside every student project a lot of contextual material like an instructor reflection, student reflections, responses from our editorial collective, and information about the course and assignment. This brings pedagogical goals and students' learning experiences to the forefront of the journal. In addition to student, editorial, and instructor collaboration, students often work together to create these multimedia projects. This example by Hannah Charlton, The Shadow of Turning. Hannah Charlton illustrated a poem written by a fellow undergraduate student, Hannah Hall, and it appears in the journal as a PDF and also as a Wix project. So throughout the presentation, we've toured through the various modes of memory, and we would like to end now with an invitation for you to forget that journey. As Bradford Vivian points out in his article for Currents, the rhetoric of forgetting in the form of deleting the past helps open up room for ruptures and for revolutionary futures. So with that in mind, we hope you enjoy the rest of the showcase. Thank you very much.